quill, but actually those were the foundation works where which led people think about the use of this hypothermia or cooling therapy to protect a newborn brain which is which has been suffering from asphyxia or HIE. And after that, we can see there is another good publication in 1972, then historical controls in over 200 asphyxiated units who were cooled and who were immersed in cold water. So in the modern era, starting from the beginning of this millennium, plenty of trials were taken place, like Sita Shankaran, which is a very well-known author of this therapeutic hypothermia. Then George, others as well. So there are common findings of all the, there is a very renowned trial which is called Cool Cap trial. So all of these research works concluded the common findings that therapeutic hypothermia is protective to the asphyxiated newborn. How does it work? Mechanism of this hypothermic neuroprotection or therapeutic hypothermia are still unclear, but it works. It really works, and it is already proven. Broadly, we can say that cooling suppresses many of the pathways leading to delayed cell death, reduces cellular metabolic demand, excessive accumulation of cytotoxins, that also is reduced by hypothermia, like glutamate and oxygen-free radicals during hypoxic ischemia. And also, it inhibits post-ischemic inflammatory reaction and the intracellular pathways leading to apoptosis-like cell death. So if I show you diagrammatically, so this is a graphical representation of magnetic resonance spectroscopy, where you can see there are two panels. Apparently, this looks a clumsy picture, but if you see carefully, things are not very difficult to understand. If you see the upper panel, which is showing the high energy phosphate constituents in the brain, like NTP and EPP. So these are high energy phosphates in the brain. You can see the red line, and you can see the blue line as well. So blue line represents the baby who underwent hypothermia, and the red line represents the baby who did not undergo hypothermia, or a baby who remained normothermic. So we can easily make out that this baby's the phosphate or high energy phosphate compounds in the brain is maintained like near normal level, and in the normothermic babies they are losing high phosphate compounds drastically. And you can see this the other graphs as well, where you can see multiple peaks and overall higher level of ATP and other high energy phosphate compounds. And in this graph, the red one, where the baby is kept normothermic, you can see much lower level of ATP, which will basically lead to secondary energy failure and injury to the brain. And the lower panel, if you look at this, you see the lactate level, which is quite high in the normothermic group, which means there is significant acidosis going on in the brain cell. And in the hypothermic group, the hypothermia is helping to keep the lactate level low. So this is again causing a neuroprotection to the baby, which is quite obvious. And these pictures are taken from MR spectroscopy. When to cool? There are a number of protocols, number of guidelines from different institutes from different corner of the world, but actually by and large those all are quite similar, except a very few variation from center to center or country to country in the context of their individual population. So this particular criteria I have picked up from Royal Children's Hospital Australia, their guideline. So the criteria to cool the baby is 35 weeks or more gestational age and more than 1.8 kilos. Previously, it was the cutoff was 2 kilos. Now it is 1.8, and it is accepted in most of the centers, most of the countries. Age has to be less than 6 years of age, 6 hours, sorry. And then evidence of asphyxia as defined by a presence of at least two of the following four criteria, like Apgar score 5 or less at 10 minutes, or continued need for resuscitation with positive pressure ventilation with or without chest compression at 10 minutes. I'm sorry about this typo error. This should be minutes. Cord pH or arterial pH less than 7.0 or base deficit of 12 or more within 60 minutes of birth. In some centers, it is taken as 15 or more, but 12 is actually more practiced. And clinically defined moderate or severe, i.e. stage 2 or 3, based on modified Sarnath and Sarnath classification. So what are the main features of therapeutic hypothermia? The criteria of therapeutic hypothermia, our primary objective, primary goal would to bring down baby's body temperature to a very low level, which is 32.5 to 32.5. So the range will be plus minus 0.5 degrees, 30 plus minus 0.5 degrees, and we immediately insert a temperature probe either in the esophagus or in the rectum. So esophageal or rectal temperature monitoring with a goal of 32.5 to 33.5 degrees Celsius. Vitals monitoring as usual, crucial for any babies, and this is more important for these babies as well, because this hypothermia may cause some disturbance in the vital functions of the baby. So I have to be extremely careful in monitoring the vital functions. And we keep the baby with this low body temperature of 32.5 to 33.5 degrees for 72 hours. And after that, we gradually rewarm the baby at a rate of about 0.5 centimeters every hour until the baby becomes normothermic. So it takes about 6 to 8 hours for the baby from hypothermia to normothermia. How about feeding the baby during this hypothermia? Well, the popular practice is to keep the infant nothing by mouth during the period of cooling and rewarming. A recent survey found that many units offer small volumes of enteral feeds during the period of therapeutic hypothermia. And a recent retrospective study found that administration of minimal enteral feed is safe in infant undergoing therapeutic hypothermia. So if you want to feed, you can start feeds, but usually it is practice that should be a small volume of feeds, like 5 to 10 ml per kg per day. A common question is asked by the residents and trainees and also non-neonatology colleagues that how is the difference between head cooling or total body cooling? Is there any preference one over the other? So the answer in one sentence is actually they both are quite same. There can be some minor differences in the outcome, like EEG abnormalities and MRI findings. If head cooling babies, but actually, most of the studies concluded that there is no significant difference in short-term and long-term outcome in head cooling and sedative head cooling and whole body cooling. How about 6 hours? Is this really strictly to be maintained? Baby has to be cooled in within 6 hours only. What if the baby is reaching the hospital at 7 hours of age, at 8 hours of age, or even at 10 hours of age? Well, the practice in most of the places is actually up to 6 hours. However, conducted to see the effect of therapeutic hypothermia for the babies with HIE coming after 6 hours, and in fact 6 hours to 12 hours, they also concluded that among the term infants with HIE of this particular age group, in fact 6 to 24 hours age group, after birth compared with non-cooling babies, they have shown much better outcome in terms of death, in terms of disability, and other neurological outcomes. So actually, the cutoff of 6 hours is not very hard in us. You can include the babies even beyond 6 hours of age as well. So in general, if we talk about the complications of therapeutic hypothermia, this is quite safe modality of treatment with very few minor side effects. So what are the common side effects or complications like arrhythmia, bradycardia? There can be hypotension as well, and also pulmonary hypertension. Baby can have pulmonary hypertension from before as well, which can be aggravated, or hypothermia may induce pulmonary hypertension. Okay, so these are the few with some dermatological side effects also. Especially the thrombocytopenia, which is quite common. We have a recent baby who underwent hypothermia, and platelet count at the beginning it was more than 150,000, and within like 3 to 4 days count came down as low as 19,000 only. So high thrombocytopenia is quite common, and some babies may develop even coagulopathy as well. Metabolic acidosis, decreased clearance of lactic acid, and altered glucose metabolism leading to hypo or hyperglycemia are quite commonly found problems in the therapeutic hypothermic babies. Drug metabolism and excretion of drugs and also metabolites might be modified cooling. So if the baby is receiving the drugs which needs to be monitored, they needed to be monitored more frequently, especially medications like anticonvulsant, and also like nephrotoxic medication, antibiotics like gentamicin, amikacin, vancomycin. So if we're using those drugs, we need to be careful, and we have to be vigilant about the toxic level of these drugs. Infection, typically, it is said that cooling has immunosuppressive effects, but meta-analysis of large trials did not show any incidence of infection in the cooled infants. There are some situations when you must consider stop cooling at any stage of this hypothermia. So if there is a persistent hypoxemia with 100% oxygen, of course, you can try ventilation as well. By the way, most of these babies actually do not need mechanical ventilation. Still, the baby is not maintaining normal PO2 level or normal saturation with 100% oxygen. If there is life-threatening coagulopathy, and also if there is significant arrhythmia except sinus bradycardia requiring treatment, then you have to consider stopping cooling therapy. There are some adjuvant therapies as well, but most of these are still in the research level besides therapeutic hypothermia, like some endogenous substances, for example, erythropoietin, darbepoietin, stem cell, melatonin. They are in the clinical trial stage, and also like remote ischemic preconditioning, endocannabinoids. These are undergoing preclinical studies, and some other exogenous substances as well. For example, xenon, allopurinol, magnesium sulfate. These are in the stage of clinical trial. So hopefully some of these will come up in the future as adjuvant therapy with therapeutic hypothermia. Regarding outcomes, as we normally all know that mild hypoxic ischemic encephalopathy babies, survival is expected. However, and also we expect that neurologically these babies be normal. But a recent evidence states that the infants with mild HIE have increased incidence of abnormal findings on the MRI of the brain, as well as long-term neurodevelopmental outcome. So even mild HIE babies also can have some neurodevelopmental problems in the future. Moderate HIE babies undergoing therapeutic hypothermia have a mortality rate of about 14 to 17%. So it's about 1 in 5 babies can die. And cooled infants with moderate to HIE who survive disability. So death and disability, not uncommon in the moderate to severe hypoxic ischemic encephalopathy. In the severe HIE group, we all know that mortality is very high, which can be half to three quarter of the babies by 1 month, and 80% of survivors will have significant mental retardation, cerebral palsy, seizure, microcephaly, and other major neurological consequences. I will conclude my presentation with BADS. So we all should take appropriate measure in the prevention of perinatal asphyxia rather than treatment of perinatal asphyxia. Therapeutic hypothermia is the recommended modality of treatment for perinatal asphyxia. The sooner the better, preferably within 6 hours. Decision making is very crucial, but we can consider the babies who are coming even later than 6 hours as well. Currently recommended for 35 weeks or more and 1.8 kg or more. In fact, some centers are trialing this therapeutic hypothermia for the babies up to 34 weeks, but 1.8 is still the cutoff for everywhere in the world. And whole body cooling versus selective head body cooling, as such, there is none of them superior. I mean, either of these two are superior to other. That's not the case. Two are considered as equally effective. So with this, I would like to conclude my presentation. If you have any questions or queries.